Oud is goes by a lot of different names. It goes by aloe's wood, it goes by agar wood, it goes by eagle's wood. Oud, as I mentioned, is the Arabic.
Oud, properly pronounced, literally means wood in Arabic. And it's also the word that the Arabs used to describe the lute, the famous string instruments. So what we're talking about is specifically a scent that is referring to either a type of incense or a type of perfume oil that is derived from the aquilaria tree.
What happens is in this particular species, aquilaria, and there's many kind of subspecies to that, which the process happens in. The heartwood gets infected and essentially reacts to the infection by growing a fungus in the heart, in the center of the tree, in the heartwood of the tree. And that fungus permeates the wood and then is used, the wood is extracted from the tree and the wood has been used for thousands of years.
And so the antibody that the tree produces is what makes it perfect.
It's found, references to aloe's wood are found in the Old Testament, found in ancient Eastern scripture as well. So it's very much a global, universal practice.
There's a real kind of culture that surrounds its use, the idea of its use for not only for scent and perfumery purposes, but its use as a something that brings people together. This is an age of great confusion and challenge and difficulty. People need something that's going to improve their mental and spiritual state. So I think something like Oud, which has historically been used for that purpose, is even more necessary in the modern age. There's not a lot of companies in the United States that specialize in what we do. There are a few, and I personally know some of them, and some are might be able to be trusted, and others I wouldn't buy from because they've never even stepped foot in Asia.
The fact of the matter is, most people are not going to get on a boat and a plane and a train and potentially a motorcycle or a donkey or a this or that to get to the places that you need to go to really source out the highest quality perfumes and the highest quality oils.
Yeah, I mean, I think like our ability to go to Asia, to countries like Indonesia, Cambodia, Laos, Thailand, and to really kind of be on the ground there has been really beneficial for us and for the company, just because we have a first-hand experience, we've walked through the jungles, going and looking for trees. We've gone to farms, like we've been to distilleries. We've been to warehouses where stuff's stored and markets where it's sold. You know, in some pretty remote locations. So it's been
why?
Because like to me, it's not just like a hobby.
Travel hours and hours in my boat, my car, come to a spot, you're expecting to meet someone, spot's closed. Come through the territory. Centuries old
outlet here in this particular city. Family, kind of father-son family business. A very standard retail
shop. What does that mean?
That means that a customer coming in is, for all intents and purposes, at the mercy of the owner. Have you seen a decrease in quality in the past 2 years?
Yes. I told you earlier.
You can't just like jump on a plane and go to Burma and get off the plane and be like, okay, I'm gonna go find oud. Like, it doesn't work like that. Like, the oud business is cutthroat. It's cutthroat, it's filled with deception, it's filled with thieves, it's filled with people who are trying to make a quick buck.
Like any other valuable commodity, there's a supply chain. I mean, there's a way that it gets into the hand of the end user. The reality is that there's two problems with having too many folks between you and the distributors or suppliers. One is price, right? Because everyone's trying to get their cut along the way. The second is quality and making sure that you're getting your customer the best product. And so for us, we do our best to kind of go as far up the supply chain as we possibly can. And there's a limit to that. Again, we're not growing oud trees in some undisclosed location in Southeast Asia, but we are getting as high up to the top of the chain as we possibly can. We've made it past security. We just got through security now, so we're coming through. Thing is that when it comes to the amount of money that people have spent on adequately supplying their warehouses, people take this very serious. It's a multi-billion dollar.
Product is grown and where the product comes from.
The average person walks in, they don't know if a wood has been altered or not. They don't know if it's been waxed or if it's had oil added to it. People don't know. I mean, it just looks like wood. You wouldn't know. They don't know that you should always be looking at the outside of the wood and the inside of the wood and making sure that there's consistency. We know that. And we're going to tell you. We're going to tell you, people have brought wood and said, oh, I bought this in Saudi Arabia, or I bought this in Dubai, or I bought this in wherever. And a lot of times it's trash because people are making money off of them. They're getting ripped off.
So not only do you sell oud to your customers, you help educate them through the process?
Absolutely. And that's why we call it oudimentary. Like elementary school, oudimentary school. That you're coming and you're learning and you're becoming a student of the wood, so to speak, a student of the lifestyle. We're not going to rip you off. And that's a question, that's an ethical question for us. It has to do with almost a sanctity. It has to do with almost a sanctity of the wood.
this is something that I'm really, really, I have a deep passion for, and I want to learn it from the very, very beginning to the very, very end, and everything that it entails. So in order to do that, you got to go walk through the jungle and try and spot a tree. So we're currently off the west coast of peninsular Malaysia, kind of the northern part, close to the border with Thailand. We carry some woods from this region. I've done a bit of writing and research on the different species that produce aloes wood in this region, so we're taking the opportunity on the trip to kind of do some hikes through the jungle and looking for, see if we can spot some trees.
Part of our job is connecting the customer with this experience. And I mean, strictly from a perspective of quality, you have to be in touch with, again, the supply chain to really be able to appreciate what kind of wood you're burning, what kind of oil you're using. It's funny as it may sound, we believe in being one with the wood, being in touch with the energy and the properties that a wood has. And so for someone who's serious about it, you got to come to the source to really feel the energy.
And we love wood. We love wood.
What it really comes down to for us is developing relationships with people and maintaining those relationships. One of our suppliers, who, for obvious reasons, we won't refer to by her actual name, who we call Mama, who she has honored us in allowing us to call her Mama, and she's very much a mother-like figure to us. She's been in the business for well over 30 years, and has seen the ebbs and the flows of the oud trade, and has been really at the forefront of the game. You know, she's a big player in the game, so to speak.
Like, people know about them, you know, throughout the Arab world, throughout, you know, in Hong Kong, wherever you might go and talk about oud, they're known. They're known for having good quality. They're known for being trustworthy, and they're known for their experience in the business. So I had kind of befriended them, and I had been to their house and hung out with them, and they kind of took me under their wing and taught me, you know, how to really kind of go through weight and pick out what was good and separate grades and, you know, the whole process of distillation. And then after 6 or 7 years, there was still stuff that they hadn't showed me.
6 or 7 years?
Yeah. Of kind of going back to them and hanging out. And, like, I'd been to dinner with them and gone to their house and, like, hung out with them. And then there was still stuff that was like, okay, now you're ready to see this, but you're still not ready to see that one.
You, if you're interested, I mean, we can, I mean, later on, I take them to my house, so we can take a picture.
Yeah, exactly.
I think maybe Tuesday would be possible.
Very good day.
She's not gonna drink.
No, she's not gonna drink.
No, he will.
All
right, help. Usama.
Maghribi,
what? Ask her if she still learns anything new after 28 years.
No, he's a bad boy. My little one, my right? Little one. Every day.
Well, she's the Yoda of Oud. Right? It's like she's the mother of our Oud experience. I would definitely consider her one of my teachers. She has a very, very profound presence. Guitar mastery in anything speaks for itself. So she's a master. One of the only ones I've ever met, a true master. And this is a relationship that we've been developing for, you know, close to 10 years. And it's taken patience. Like sitting with any other master of anything, a master of tea, or a master of the martial arts, or a master of a language, or a master of one of the spiritual traditions. You have to take what you get according to when and how they want to give it to you.
Mm.
You can't rush the process, right? And what that means for an end user is that by being connected to the right people, you're part of that chain and you're part of that experience. To buy from like a, you know, a retail store in a mall somewhere, the reality is that the person behind the counter, it's just business for them. That's just their 9-to-5. That's just their job. As far as I'm concerned, that's not really burning a Oud. Comparing that to going, like I went to a boutique, specialized Chinese tea house once, and I ordered an oolong tea prepared in Gung Fu style. And the gentleman who's working there was a white American guy. He bowed and he said, "Pardon me, sir, my teacher hasn't given me permission to prepare that type of tea." And I literally, like, I had chills on my whole body when he said, and I wanted to just hug the guy, because I was like, right, like that's what we're talking about. We're talking about preservation of age-old, time-tested, centuries-old traditions, and Oud is one of those.
Why do you think it is that your teacher, the master, doesn't want herself revealed?
Because mastery is not a cheap thing, and it's not something to be taken lightly.
Started the business because we loved the thing that we were gonna sell, and that we were passionate about it, and that we wanted to learn as much as possible about it and offer our findings to like-minded people, you know, so people who really cared about it, you know. So I think, like, we're not driven by money. We're not driven by, even now.
So what are you driven by?
We're driven by bringing a product that, to people in the West specifically, that I feel is gonna be beneficial for them on all the different levels that we talked about. I think people's lives are improved by the product that we sell.
Hey, mambo, mambo Italiano. Hey, mambo, mambo Italiano. Go, go, go. You mixed up Siciliano, all you Calabrese do the mambo like a crazy with a hey mambo. Don't want a tarantella, hey mambo. No more the mozzarella, hey mambo. Mambo Italiano, try an enchilada with the fish baccalà. Hey